New Mutants number 14 is the beginning of a new era of Krakoa's New Mutants title, with the creative unit of Vita, Ayala, and Rod Reis taking over the post-Tennis Swords title, and finally giving it a new, clear, exciting direction. Today I'll answer, who are the many kid mutants here, and what should you know about them from X-Men history? Where does Shadow King end and Amahl Farouk begin? Would Gabby, aka Honey Badger, aka Scout, actually get resurrected on Krakoa if she died, and theories and predictions for things to come in both New Mutants, X-Men, and the Reign of X, this post-Ten of Swords era that we are in. Hey everybody, I'm Dave Busing, founder and editor-in-chief of comicbookherald.com. You are listening to Krakin Krakoa number 134, a review of New Mutants number 14. If you like the Comic Book Herald YouTube channel or Krakin Krakoa, please consider subscribing, liking, and sharing, and commenting here with your thoughts on the comments and theories. Spoilers for discussed comics will follow. Writer Vita Ayala, artist Rod Reis, letters by Travis Lanham. The issue opens with the origin of Amahl Farouk, 16th century. We're running it way back. He is a young boy with powers, with mutant abilities manifesting, and of course, early in the story, his father tragically dies of the plague. And then, and only then, he comes to know the Shadow King, lurking, of course, in the mysterious dark. Now, this is the first time reading New Mutants in the Hickman era of X-Men, in the Dawn of X, and now into the Reign of X, that I've had a real hell yeah moment from the pages of New Mutants. I was super excited about this reveal, about this surprise opening for this comic. There's a couple major items to note right off the bat. The first is something that came up a fair amount when Amahl was seen in Empire X-Men number 2, for literally a single page in that comic, but it's that Amahl is a mutant and that Shadow King is a psychic entity, and despite their longtime bonding, they are actually two separate things, right? They are two separate entities. And secondly, this is our first official connection to the Reign of X teaser promo image, which had the apparent Shadow King visage in the back right corner. Sorry, Brew Truthers, I don't think it's going to actually be revealed to have been Brew. So jumping way to the end, to the very end of New Mutants, by issue's end, we learn that Amahl is in a cave on Krakoa, welcoming the likes of Anole, Komsar or Kosmar, No Girl, and Rainboy to share stories of their big day in New Mutant Training Academy, which we'll of course discuss shortly, because that's the crux, that's the bulk of this issue. Now, my guess would be that this is actually Amahl Farouk without the Shadow King entity. Again, he is a mutant, and he would, in theory, be allowed on Krakoa, but what is that character, right? Like, what is Amahl without the Shadow King entity? We don't really know, so I'm, like, fascinated and really excited, honestly, that Ayala and Reis are starting their story with perhaps more flashbacks into Farouk's beginnings and like what his life was like throughout the centuries. That is a story I'll be eager to see develop in flashbacks throughout this run. I hope we're going to get more of it. And then of course, just having like Amahl Farouk on Krakoa, this has been up in the air, whether or not this was confirmed, whether or not this would be allowed. Again, he's a longtime enemy of Professor X, as we'll talk about, like the archenemy in a lot of ways. And one of like the most sinister kind of like mutant villains when combined with the Shadow King entity. So the fact that he's hiding out in a cave, is that, who is that unknown to, right? Who does the Quiet Council know and nobody else? Is it only Professor X and Moira? Is it only Moira, right? You have all sorts of options about like who knows that he's here and what is he like. I'm actually kind of thinking that he's probably, because he's, my guess is, not possessed by the Shadow King entity here, probably not like sinisterly manipulating these children as much as this is like sort of suggesting. But of course, time will tell. This is only the first issue in this creative team's run. Now, again, as I said, Shadow King is well known as a longtime bitter enemy of Professor X and Storm for that matter, and his psychic abilities have really been captured magnificently in the FX series Legion, of course, focused on Professor X's son, David Haller. I actually just coincidentally happened to be watching some of that this morning, and season 2, and definitely watch Legion because it's fascinating, but also like good portrayal of what the Shadow King and Amahl Farouk can be as a character. That said, I also wouldn't sleep on Amahl's ties to the New Mutants, specifically Jean, Karma from the mid-80s Chris Claremont written New Mutants, where Farouk is the Shadow King took hold of Karma and manipulated her, turning her into a massive glutton before finally being freed. Given Ayala's focus on Karma's nightmares in the early going of this issue, New Mutants number 14, I'd anticipate those issues resurface and those connections will be explored. Plus, check out New Mutants number 31 to 34 for more. I toss in Uncanny X-Men number 117 for that Shadow King Professor X battle, and the Muir Island saga for good measure for some recommended reads around Shadow King AF. So elsewhere in the issue. So that's the big Shadow King reveal, which, for, as a fan of that villain, as someone who grew up, you know, really loving just sort of the 90s renditions artistically of what that villain can be, I'm excited to see that as a potential threat emerging, or a potential just interesting character in the New Mutants run. But the main focus of the issue is that Danny, Jean, James Proudstar, Rain, and Magic, they identify the youth of Krakoa that they need some structure. I really appreciate the clear need for education and training on Krakoa, and I definitely didn't realize how much I was missing something as common and familiar to longtime X-Men readers as a good old Danger Room session. I don't doubt Professor X's pride in receiving this letter from his students. You know, definitely Professor X values, like, especially the New Mutants, because for a time he raised them as kids, you know, before he gallivanted off in space for the 8 millionth time. But I'm definitely irritated here by Professor X's and the Council's kind of massive oversight when it comes to, like, setting up a nation that has any sort of structure or like things to do for the children of that nation. I mean, it just goes to show that straight up starting a mutant nation takes a lot more than anyone was quite prepared for. And I really appreciate the quote unquote new mutants, who are now, of course, themselves adults and themselves have been educators at the Xavier Institute in the past, taking it upon themselves to say, yeah, we kind of need that back in place. Like, not literally let's start a school again, but it's got those vibes. And I would find that very exciting. So the kid mutants that these new mutants are taking in are Fauna, the little kid we see Jean Grey lead to Krakoa in House of X number 1, and who we've seen since causing mischief in Cable number 1. We have Anol, an Academy X mutant, as seen recently in X-Factor number 5. He's kind of like the Lizard and has been one of the more regular players across X comics throughout the 2000s. We have Nature Girl, a fan favorite of mine, debuted in the second volume of Wolverine and the X-Men, and became a favorite of mine during the Christina Strain written semi-recent Generation X, a series I would highly recommend to readers who may be skipped out on a lot of these sort of 2020s X-Men pre-House and Powers. We have Scout, who honestly, when I saw the name Scout, I didn't even recognize who this was, but it's Gabby, and I guess no longer using the gag name Honey Badger. Gabby's a clone of Laura Kinney, aka Wolverine, and if you don't know about Gabby, check out the all-new Wolverine series written by Tom Taylor. That's another one of my post-Secret Wars all new, all different X-Men favorites. We have Rainboy here, who I did not know anything about other than that he's made of water and he debuted during the Peter Milligan written X-Men in the mid-2000s. We have Petra, who I would say is definitely the most surprising entry on the roster, as we've seen Petra most recently aimlessly partying day and night with Vulcan and Sway on the moon. We have Sprite, not to be confused with Kate Pryde's one-time nickname. She debuted in Wolverine and the X-Men, and she's like a rocky blue fairy from China. Dust. I like Dust a lot, a creation from the Grant Morrison-written New X-Men days, who has the mutant ability to be more effective as a version of Sandman. More recently, Dust also has ties to the Champions. We have No Girl, who's probably the most interesting one on here, because Martha Johansson, another Grant Morrison creation, she's a superpower brain in a jar, and No Girl is probably most interesting to me because of her long friendship with Ernst, who was revealed to be connected to Cassandra Nova in Morrison and Silvestri's riff on Days of Future Past, and also has some Sinister Secrets connections. And then finally, we have Cosmar, the newest of the New Mutants. Cosmar debuted in the last story from the Ed Brisson run on his volume of New Mutants. She's a mutant with some kind of nightmare reality warping powers, and in this very issue, trying to come to grips with not just letting those things wreak havoc on all of the mutants in Krakoa around her. So we get, again, actual mutant training sessions, which brought me great joy. We get the kids training first, and then we get the new mutants themselves showing off basically how they do it, how they train, how they combine their powers in synergies and combos, and basically that being what they're trying to teach these younger mutants. We've seen this conversation around synergy of mutant abilities in Empire and expansively in Sword Number 1, an issue that came out last week, where combining abilities is referred to as mutant technology. And we see this, I think, displayed visually very, very effectively by Reis, and then lettered here by Lanham, where you have Warpath and Warlock in a synergy explaining what that is, as opposed to just saying, yeah, James Prostar's wearing awesome Warlock armor. It's amazing, and I love it. Of course, it's very, very fun. So after the training sessions, which of course the kids love, and I love myself, Gabby is here, and she is asking the trainers the hard questions about clones, and I love her for it. Directly asking about Evan / Genesis, Kid Apocalypse, and Madeline Pryor. Magic does not have a great answer for Gabby about these questions, telling her that Evan could still be in the resurrection queue, which feels to me like a major cop-out, honestly. Like, yeah, technically, I guess he could be, but why? You know? Like, how long? We know that's a long list, but at the same time, like, that could be a data page to me. Like, what is the resurrection queue? Who are some known mutants who are still on there that are literally just waiting, and why are they still waiting? There's some more defenses excuses of not bringing Madeline Pryor back in Hellions, which also kind of reveals that Krakoa's Quiet Council has some major leaks. Like, why is that public knowledge? I don't really know. Mostly revolving around that time Maddie tried to burn the world in an inferno, which, you know, on one hand, fair point. But as others point out, you know, Mr. Sinister, Mr. Freaking Sinister, is on the Quiet Council. So holding up, like, you know, mass casualties as a reason to not resurrect a mutant is kind of BS in this era of X-Men. I don't know. I'm nervous for Gabby here because I feel like Krakoa actually will not really be resurrecting clones, but maybe it does just become a who you know situation. If Gabby dies, she'll have Laura advocating for her, assuming Laura makes it safely out of the vault. In Evan's case, well, Deadpool wasn't allowed on Krakoa, so I don't know who's pushing for it. I appreciate that this comic is very directly asking the questions, though, because it's something I've been talking about on Krakoa and Krakoa for a while, and I am really curious to see it played out, and like every implication from Gabby's question and the way it's answered here implies this is going to be an ongoing conversation. So, I mean, all in all, I'm really excited about this new vision for New Mutants. Definitely the most excited I've been about this series. I would say even like with the early Hickman and Reis stuff, with the New Mutants in space, just because that never really felt, oddly enough, like a New Mutants thing, you know, because it was this kind of experimental, like two creators working on the same title thing. Between this and the preposterously delayed Children of the Atom, I'm very into the idea of Ayala taking on the direction of Krakoa's youth. Honestly, if the concept of Children of the Atom, just like, because that book seems to never be able to come out for whatever reason, maybe Marvel's, you know, in the X office just like, yeah, maybe we don't need it because you're doing everything you were going to do there in New Mutants. Like, if that just morphed into plot lines in New Mutants, that'd be fine too. I'd be totally cool with that. But I like this vision for the youth of Krakoa. I think it's a good companion piece, especially to like X Factor and the work that Leah Williams and David Baldion are doing there, as we just saw in X Factor number 5, where, you know, I definitely underestimated like how excited X-Men fans would be about the return of the Academy X kids and stuff like that, right? So for a lot of readers, like, these are the mutants you grew up with, these are the younger mutants, you can do a lot more fun things than you can do with, like, you know, Scott Summers, a mutant with so much history and so much baggage. So this issue rocked. I thought it was great. A great start. I'm super pumped the Shadow King's involved. Next, the Krakoa reads that we're going to have a Rager, which means we are going to have a young mutant party, is every implication, although seeing as we just saw a version of that in X Factor number 5, perhaps this one will be a little bit different. But hey, let me know your comments, your theories, your ideas about this issue. If you're excited about this direction, this reset essentially of New Mutants, let me know. I want to hear in the comments here. And of course, if you like these reviews, please consider liking and subscribing. The other thing you can do if you like Comic Book Herald and my work, you can go to patreon.com/comicbookherald. You can support the site for as little as $1 a month to get some cool benefits. And one thing you can get there is if you like listening to these reviews in podcast form, I release all Krakoa and Krakoa comic book reviews exclusively podcast style on the Patreon. You can get like normal podcast stuff over on Best Comics Ever, but the reviews specifically only go up to the patrons. I want to thank in particular my mysterious benefactors, Jesse W., Professor Pride, Cole Weathers, Martin Lopez, Chris Isidro, Brent Bowser, Professor X3769, and PD Appleseed. Thank you so much for your generous support. I'm Dave. You can find my stuff at comicbookherald.com, at comicbookherald, pretty much anywhere online. Look for Best Comics Ever and My Marvelous Year podcast for more from me. Thanks for everybody for listening, and as always, enjoy the comics.